Well, we've covered the first two phases of glycolysis. Now let's enter the energy yielding phase of glycolysis, in which two molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate go through this last phase. We show one on the right and one on the left. The left is identical to the right. The first step is the conversion of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate to glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrate. I'm sorry, we convert glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate to 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate or biphosphoglycerate. In other words, we're adding another phosphate group. And here's that inorganic phosphate coming in here. And you say, wait a second, you're taking glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate over here and you're adding another phosphate to it. Where's the ATP? Isn't ATP donating this phosphate? No, that phosphate, it comes from an inorganic pool of phosphates. And this reaction happens because of the oxidation of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate that's occurring, concomitant with the reduction of NAD plus to NADH. And this reaction, 6, coupled with 7, which takes 1,3-biphosphoglycerate and converts it to 3-phosphoglycerate, has a net delta G0 of positive 1.5. But remember, the pulling and pushing of biochemical reactions based on actual cellular concentrations of reactants and products allows this to occur. And in the process, in step 7, we now take one of the phosphates that was on 1,3-biphosphoglycerate and remove it, and that is added to ADP to produce ATP. What's that sound? Oh, that's ATP being produced. And remember, there are now two ATPs being produced because there are two molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate that have entered the energy yielding phase. In the next step, in step 8, we have 3-phosphoglycerate that is converted to 2-phosphoglycerate by a phosphoglyceromutase. So here is 3-phosphoglycerate and 2-phosphoglycerate. The phosphate has changed carbons that it is on. And this has a delta G of 1.1, so it's effectively neutral. Again, in actual cellular conditions, this might be close to negative, and this would proceed readily because of the concentration of reactants and products. Then in step 9, we're almost done here, step 9, 2-phosphoglycerate is acted upon by the enzyme enolase to produce phosphoenyl pyruvate. All through this process, we are dealing with, through the energy yielding phase of this, we are dealing with three carbon compounds up until the last step. So we still have three carbons in our pathway here. And water is produced here. So this is a condensation reaction. Water is yielded. And we now have, under the action of enolase, the production of phosphoenyl pyruvate, delta G of close to zero, just barely positive. In the cell, this would be negative. And then finally, phosphoenyl pyruvate is converted to pyruvate. And here is pyruvate. We have a 3-carbon molecule pyruvate. And what's that sound? Oh, ATP is produced again. So now we have produced two more molecules of ATP. At the end of glycolysis, we have two molecules of pyruvate, and we have produced a net yield of two molecules of ATP. We've invested 2 at the beginning, but we've yielded 4 in the energy yielding phase. Also, we have produced 1 NADH molecule because one molecule of NAD was, I'm sorry, we produced 2 molecules of NADH because there are 2 molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate that enter the energy yielding phase. So we have 2 reductions of 2 NAD molecules yielding NADH and NADH. So that is glycolysis. And now we have, what are we going to do with pyruvate? And let's consider the overall reaction of glucose in glycolysis and what the next steps will be in the oxidation of foodstuffs. Now, as I mentioned previously, as we'll see shortly, pyruvate, which is a three-carbon molecule, will donate a carbon and oxygens to form carbon dioxide and will thus yield a two-carbon compound that will enter the next stages of oxidation of sugars. And we will treat that shortly, but first I want to go do an overview of glycolysis. And so let's do that right now. Here we have, we start with glucose, C6H12O6, glucose, plus two inorganic phosphates, plus two NADs, yields two pyruvates, which are three carbon compounds, two molecules of water, two molecules of reduced NAD, that is two molecules of NADH, two hydrogen ions, and two ATPs. What's that sound? Oh yeah, that's ATP again. So this is the overall reaction, and we can see that at the end we're left with NADHs and pyruvates in a way that need to be accounted for. We have a net yield of two ATPs, and that doesn't seem very efficient. You've taken one glucose molecule and you only get two ATPs out? Well, in that sense, glycolysis is inefficient. And we'll talk about the evolution of the glycolytic pathway and its role in evolution of the overall respiratory pathway in a little while. But right now, let's deal with what happens to the pyruvates and the NADHs that are products of the oxidation of glucose. So far, though, we have two ATPs produced, and that's good. We have some energy produced by glycolysis from glucose. And after glycolysis, of course, we'll be dealing with the rest of the oxidation of glucose. But right now, we're just finishing up with glycolysis. Now, if glycolysis is going to continue, we must recycle the NADH to NAD+, and we can do that in one of two ways. One is to take the pyruvates that are yielded at the end of glycolysis and run those through aerobic respiration, as we will. But another way, in the absence of oxygen, fermentation can occur, in which an organic molecule is the final electron acceptor, and it will accept an electron from NADH, thereby oxidizing it to NAD, and thereby NAD plus will be recycled, and NADH will be oxidized, and an organic molecule will be reduced as an electron acceptor. It accepts an electron from NADH. Let's examine how pyruvate ties into that recycling of NAD plus that is needed to keep going with glycolysis, to promote glycolysis. We need NAD plus, and how does pyruvate tie into that? Well, when oxygen is present, it's oxidized to a compound that we'll see in detail, acetyl-CoA, which enters the Krebs cycle. But when oxygen is absent, we see that pyruvate can be reduced in order to oxidize NADH back to NAD+. Either way, pyruvate will play a role, either being oxidized or by being reduced, to recycle NAD+. So let's look at that. Here we have pyruvate at the end of glycolysis. Let's imagine we have a case without oxygen so that pyruvate cannot enter the rest of the respiratory pathway because oxygen is unavailable, and we know that oxygen is the final electron acceptor in that respiratory pathway. So let's say without oxygen we have pyruvate produced at the end of glycolysis. Two molecules of pyruvate for every molecule of glucose that enters the glycolytic pathway. Well, let's say in muscle cells, pyruvate becomes reduced to lactate, lactic acid. And when your muscles, if you work out really hard and your muscles enter into an anaerobic phase, there's not enough oxygen to supply them, they go into an anaerobic state. And pyruvate at the end of glycolysis instead of being run through respiration, is reduced to lactate, lactic acid. And that's what makes your muscles, when you work out, makes your muscles sore. Lactic acid makes your muscles sore. And in the process, since pyruvate here is reduced to lactate, NADH becomes oxidized to NAD+, thereby recycling NAD+ for further use in the glycolytic cycle here, or for the for the glycolytic cycle up above here that leads to pyruvate. So NAD plus is recycled for use in glycolysis. That occurs in let's say skeletal muscle. We use yeast. Yeast will run fermentation in which pyruvate becomes oxidized, and in so doing produces a 2-carbon compound, ethanol, donating carbon and oxygen to CO2, carbon dioxide. And so here acetaldehyde acts as an electron acceptor from NADH, and in so doing becomes ethanol that we drink. So we ferment grains, which basically have glucose ultimately in them. We take the sugars that are in grains and we ferment them to ethanol by yeast, which run this anaerobic without oxygen pathway of fermentation. And in the process of reducing acetaldehyde to ethanol, NADH becomes oxidized. And this NAD plus can be then used for more glycolysis to produce pyruvate. So you can see that pyruvate plays a key role in recycling NAD plus for further use in glycolysis in the absence of oxygen. And with that, we'll end our treatment of glycolysis now and ask, what happens when you have oxygen present and you are going to utilize pyruvate in downstream pathways of respiration? And that's where we'll pick up with next week.